Welcome to News from Underground, the best source to get your consistent and principled anarchist news on the internet. Today we have a new co-host here.
Hey, I'm Aaron, ex-military, which kind of made me become an anarchist. It's funny how the working for the government will make you become an anarchist.
You see a lot of the evil right there.
Yeah. It's just so much wasteful spending, so much basically violation of rights and different stuff like that. Other than that, like to brew beer and passionate about beer, and definitely the government's too much involved in beer, so that's, you're probably gonna hear a lot about beer from me.
All right, versus talking about, like, people talk about this magical button we can push and, you know, can government can disappear. Of course, there is no such thing as a button, and there's no building that you can burn down and that turns everyone into an anarchist. You know, it's all in here, right? So to push that button, it means that everyone lets go of the idea of political rulers and slaves, tax slaves. However, there was a button, and there was a button that I could push to abolish these monopolies. The first one I would advocate for abolishing would be the ABC.
Absolutely. Probably the worst, at least here in Virginia.
Right.
The worst government monopoly we have.
Right. The monopoly on distilled spirits. What would be your first monopoly?
I'm still going to go with the Fed.
The Fed?
Good choice. It's not beer. I mean, it's just paper money.
Right, yeah.
You know, I mean, beer is more important.
I love beer, but, you know, yeah, I'm going to say the Fed.
I mean, you can, like, eventually in fall, you have your bottle caps, right? So that could be a form of money from there.
Bottle caps, huh? I've seen that somewhere. Bottle caps is a form of currency. Yeah, maybe. Yeah. I think there was a video game about that.
Yeah. So I want to, I guess, pass on the first announcement. It's, I guess the first announcement, real important one, is I want to say a really great thank you to Stephen, Mike, and Rose for so much for what you've done in helping us to grow. We're here until we have real freedom in our lifetime. And he's helped donated the cap here for the mic. He's donated a lot of other equipment that we're going to start putting together here for the show. And I mean, that's where we're going. You know, this is our success story here. You know, we probably have a Bitcoin ticker up here, so you can, you know, see where the value is on a daily basis. And that's I'm in it for life. I'm in it all the way. And it's great to see someone like Stephen to be there along there with us. So thank you so much. Thank you for being a fellow champion of liberty and for helping us. And I'll see you guys at that. So we'll see you at the victory party. We'll hopefully all be there celebrating together
with beer.
With beer, yeah. So the first story we're going to go over, the one that's on everyone's lips right now: no good guys in the West. There are no good guys to cheer for in the militia takeover of an Oregon federal office building on January 2nd. The ostensible issue is the resentencing of two Oregon ranchers, Dwight Hammond and son Stephen Hammond, for arson, while the underlying issue is federal land ownership of much of the West. So I guess first thing to kind of just put out, there is no anti-government group out there. The contention is a pro-slavery group of people who are crying about being treated like slaves. That's what government does. That's what the Constitution is all about. In there, it advocates for the enslavement of future generations for a document that they had nothing to do with, that they've never gave their explicit signature to, that they never gave consent to. It outlines a way of life that has nothing to do with today, with any of these generations involved at all. I mean, that's something that people want to go back to. Great, keep it within yourselves as long as it's voluntary, consensual. But in terms of constitutionalism, that's what it is. You got what you wanted. You want government. Government's nothing but a monster that robs and murders and hurts people. And here we go again, right? It's going to prolong the inevitable, just even trying to go back to the funding basics as these kind of groups of people want to do. But I guess let's talk about the history, or I guess how this stuff sort of started. You guys have followed up on any of that?
So as far as the situation in Oregon, I guess they used to have a subsidy where basically they would graze the land. They would pay the federal government a certain amount of money to graze this land.
Right.
And then they lobbied for the government to basically reduce those fees in exchange for the ranchers receiving profit. So I think the thing that people fail to see is when the ranchers let their cattle graze this land, it cost the average taxpayer $100 million annually,
right.
Which is kind of counterproductive to the whole anti-government theme. I mean, if you're right. going to take subsidies at one point and say, no, government's bad at this point, it's kind of hypocritical.
Yeah. We don't like when government doesn't respect private property, but it's okay for us to disrespect it ourselves too and accepting these subsidies.
Right. To clarify, the people that are actually doing this, or I guess heading this little protest, are the Bundys, which are the sons of Cliven Bundy, who had this had his issue with the Bundy Ranch earlier. I think this was a year or two ago, when there were just people from all around America that showed up with arms to defend the Bundy Ranch. And you know, to a certain extent, this was, yes, a reasonable issue. I mean, the feds are coming after you. We want to defend you. But also, like you said, they were being subsidized. So it's a very sort of cherry-picking your government intrusions. Well, we're okay with you stealing from them to give to us, but just don't steal from us.
Right.
So.
Well, it goes to the same aspect. If you look at it, if you owned a ranch next to them and they let their cattle graze on your ranch, you wouldn't really, you know. I get it that all public land's owned by the people because we pay taxes. However, that's my land too. I may not be okay with you stealing $100 million from me to fund your cattle. I love hamburgers, yeah. But not for $100 million worth.
Right, right. I guess that's something to jump into really quickly and to kind of talk about public land. I guess in that there really is no such thing as public land. There's land that is ripe for homesteading that a gang of thieves and murderers prevents you from homesteading, right? Prevents you from developing it. The federal government itself owns over one third of all the land from sea to sea, all across the United States tax farms, that prevents people from building homes, from developing it, from privatizing it.
And when you say that that our money is being stolen to preserve this land or whatever, you know, and that gives us some sort of claim, and I would say it doesn't, but it's more our money is being stolen to prevent this land from being homesteaded.
Right.
And that's really where it comes down to.
Right. It was, it's just more about trying to keep people away from trying to live out in the country. It kind of seems like, right? The more land the government appropriates for itself, kind of like the situation you see in California, a lot of people trying to live off the grid. The last thing that a lot of the city politics there wants is for that to occur, because that means you're not plugged into the system, you're not giving them their taxes. So the best way they can do is just send out their enforce quotes, right? To see, well, that's not up to date, that violates some code, you need to plug yourself into our system, because somehow you're making a living without paying us. And we don't like that.
You bring up a sensitive issue with me, because I'm from Florida, and I'm actually specifically, I lived in Cape Coral, Florida, for a while, and there was this a lady in Cape Coral who was specifically living off of the grid, and the government in Cape Coral was really just bearing down on her for this. And there was a, you know, they really came down, and I actually don't know how it ended up, but it became national news, and this woman who just wanted to live off of the grid for a while was being portrayed as this complete, you know, nutterball, just because she wanted to disconnect from the government monopoly electric system and right. The government monopoly water system. And she took care of her own waste, she took care of her own water production and everything. And
it's a shame that she's labeled as a nut. She wants to get away from this form of slavery, but she's labeled as a nut. That's right. An indoctrination that we've kind of the government good, people that want to be free of government bad. I mean, I don't, if you want a slave master, that's on you. I mean, but I don't.
Right,
you know?
Right.
And I think that's what that comes down to.
Yeah, in terms of like people calling her a nut, for example, for some people were calling these, I guess this sort of group, a terrorist, but of course they won't call the same government a terrorist organization itself, right? Like if you want to look at a group of people that have occupied federal buildings, look at some kind of acts of terrorism, go to your local city hall.
Right. Well, I mean, yeah.
It drives me completely nuts that people are calling this a race issue now. People are bringing up race because, oh, why are people hesitant to call them terrorists? But, you know, the protesters in Ferguson, for one, nobody ever called the people in Ferguson terrorists.
Right.
And two, the people in Ferguson were looting and setting on fire businesses and destroying things.
Right.
All of these the only thing these people are doing are carrying guns and tenting out on federal land. Well, that's all. And it's basically abandoned land.
And as far as the Ferguson and the Baltimore riots go, if they would have burned down City Hall and the police department, I would have been more willing to get behind that than burning down Bob's Fish Market.
Right.
I think the problem is and the government's playing right into the hand, we're so divisive on race right now. I mean, just because you're a different color than I am or different ethnicity than I am, then we're at odds with each other. No, our common denominator is government that we have an issue with. It's just how we get there. I will say this whole thing in the West that I'm more willing to support them from going after a government building. I think that's ingenious. If the government was to impose force on them and kill these people, I mean, imagine the backlash. The government doesn't want that on them right now. And this stems from the whole situation.
I would actually disagree with that. I think that if the government came after them, it would end up like Waco, where the most people would actually support the government and say, oh, well, they had guns, so they're bad guys.
Yeah, but then the government has guns and they're not the bad guy all of a sudden because they have the term as government. And this whole...
Well, militia is a naughty word now.
Right.
And it really shouldn't be. It's just a matter of what you use the term militia for. I mean... Their whole argument is that they're pissed off at the fact that they were charged with arson, did their time, and I put time in quotes because it's their time, not my time.
Right.
They did their time, and then the government says, well, that's not enough. That's like me punishing my kid by taking away his Nintendo DS, and then they're saying, well, you should have spanked your kid. Now we have to come back in here and spank your kid for you. I can understand their beef. I really can with the government. However... their beef's not really with the government. It's because the government didn't go their way. I always, my quote is, people want freedom until they don't agree with it. And the reason I say that is people want freedom until it doesn't suit their needs.
I would actually say it's even the opposite. People want slavery until they don't agree with it.
I think they're pretty much synonyms for each other, just how you look at it. Glass half full, half empty. Slavery being half empty.
Yeah, maybe I'm more of a pessimist.
No, yeah, but I would agree. Slavery is still slavery, regardless of what percentage of glass is filled up. In terms of these groups, yeah, it is a pro-slavery group. But they still want advocation for government. They just want state terrorism. They don't want federal terrorism. This is what they call a form of tyranny. They want state tyranny. They want local tyranny. They still want a form of tyranny. You know, at least be consistent and just go against all of it, right? Take a stand against. But I do find, I guess, a bit commendable that they're taking their issue with the organization that is causing them strife, right? So I look at it as just people caught in just gang warfare, right? These ranchers got too little too close on government's turf, right, in terms of lighting the fires there to kind of control a lot of the development of land, right, to reuse it and to re-energize it. There was a situation, of course, when there was a wildfire on the Bureau of Management land, a way to kind of prevent that from going on your property is to light the fire on your own property. But then some fires got caught in the middle of that. And that's where the contention was drawn, in which, you know, you do this again, we're going to take you to court. They did it again without them being there, without their awareness, until after it was already started. And that's when they went to jail for a year. The federal government said they appealed that decision. Like, a year, it's not too long, they're trying to say. And so they went back again, and then there were sentenced one for 4 years, the other for 5 years. And that's where the militia was called for to release them. Right.
Well, and it makes you wonder. I mean, they have double jeopardy laws.
Right.
Like, they don't even follow their own laws. So basically, you punish someone for something, but then you agree that the punishment is not enough. I mean, at what point do we say, hey, we're tired of this? I mean, we've already said that, but I'm talking about the general public.
Right.
At what point do we start saying, hey, you know, this isn't moral? And the sad thing is the same people that are supporting this Oregon ranch thing, I guess we can call it Ranchgate.
Right, yeah. Okay, that's an acceptable
name. Ranchgate are the same people that are against the action against the police, but the people that are for the Ferguson and Baltimore situations and the thing that just happened with Tamir, I believe it was.
Right.
They're against this situation.
Now they want the police.
You know what? How about we all meet in a general ground and say, hey, the government sucks. Stop telling me what to do. You know, and we can all get along. I mean, it's not a racial thing. I would say it's a humanity thing. The fact that we are controlled by these people, and now we're the radicals, we're the nut jobs, because we don't want a slave master.
Right.
And in fact, if you say slave master nowadays, you're looked down upon, you know? But that's what it is. If you look at the definition, and people want to change definitions of stuff.
Right, you just have to define it more objectively. Yeah, it's not a race war, it's not a class war, it's a political war. It's about those people who want to enslave humanity, men, women, and children, versus those that the one real freedom, right? You have your political rulers and you have your tax slaves. And that is regardless of what how much money you have or what color you are. And that's just the way the world of statism works. These are your United Tax Firms of America. And we've come to find the situation in Ferguson, the situation with Tamir, the situation over there, the common denominator is pointing to government.
And we can't, absolutely. And the problem is we can't unite.
Right.
The problem is people want to find faults in everything else but government, because we've relied on government for this long that people can't fathom the notion of getting rid of government. And I don't mean to get off on a tangent here, but I had an argument with someone that said that we have outgrown money. And I said, I disagree. I think we've outgrown government.
Right.
I think we've outgrown government, but people
can't. We don't
have
money.
Right. Right. I mean, what's money? I mean, hey, you give me two beers, I'll wash your car.
Right.
And we've already said how much I love beer. I mean, it's a matter of what worth is. But the fact is as soon as you admit that government's at fault, people want to call you a conspiracy theorist, call you radical, call you a nut job. And they don't look at the lying factor that, hey, if you look in the news for the past 3-4 years, the common denominator have been government.
Right.
Yeah, it's because the indoctrination has reached God mode. They've, somehow the government has gotten hold of the Konami code.
Konami code.
up, down, left, B, right, start, or whatever it was.
Right.
A, B, A, B.
So that's, there's a lot of contention there. I mean, the interesting thing that was kind of fascinating, I guess you can use as an example in terms of like how would you prevent warlords from taking over? You have a situation out there like in the Bunny Ranch situation in which a voluntary militia came out there, right? These are not people who were paid to go out there. These are not people who were conscripted, to defend private property. These are people who volunteer. You know, what would happen in a free society in which there were threatening warlords? You will have people who volunteer. You have people like me, people like us. You're going to point them out. Point out who these would-be murderers are. What direction did they go to?
Yeah, that's exactly what happened. We had threatening warlords, and the community stood up against them.
Right.
And they walked away.
Yep. They had a stronger argument in terms of the more principle of property rights. Not that they universalized it and went all the way, but it's this interesting note that they went somewhere along that way, and that's an argument that government couldn't trump. And then when you have a lot of people come out there, that's an issue that they can't beat. That's an argument that they can't win over.
Well, and I will say one, if we can take a good thing from this whole situation, the Bunny Ranch, I mean, remember when that happened, what was it, last year? They met conflict with all these, and the feds backed off. I mean, they didn't want to, so I think that speaks volumes that we can invoke change. Mainly, sometimes the government doesn't always listen to words. I'm not advocating violence because I'm against violence. However,
well, that's proof that violence isn't necessary. That's proof that the brutalists are wrong.
Right.
That is not the logical conclusion. You can dismantle the government, peacefully, and not only that, but you build your community to withstand the dismantlement of government, because it will dismantle on its own.
And there was no shots fired. There were no shots fired. Yeah. The sad thing is I wish that these people in Oregon would just see that, and they hide behind the Constitution, they hide behind the American flag as just, okay? Whether or not, whether or not a symbol is a symbol, okay? But don't say, well, we like government if it does this stuff.
Right.
But we don't like government if it does this stuff. Well, you can't have both.
Right.
Government is government. They're not going to listen to you, they're going to listen to the majority, and the vocal minority is going to be shunned.
Could these people be future anarchists? Absolutely.
Yeah.
Anyone can be a future anarchist, except if you're a commie. Fuck those guys.
But I think that's the thing to take away, that these could be future future anarchists.
Right, right,
wow,
right.
Not future commies, because
right.
Those guys, fuck them.
Right.
And I think that's what we need to unite against, or unite for, is, yeah, anybody that you talk to is one step away from becoming an anarchist, because maybe I'm a hopeful that a majority of the population is saying, man, the government sucks. I mean, we see that on both sides of the political spectrum. I mean, you have right now we have Republicans and Democrats. The Democrats are hating the police right now, which is a major form of
finally
government.
Right.
But then the Republicans want limited government, but they support the police department like they're gods.
Right. I guess in terms of all that, I guess for anyone in which whatever position they are, you know, they haven't really been introduced to anarchy. They haven't really been introduced to any of these principles that we already know of.
They haven't been given the appropriate definitions.
The appropriate definitions. Right?
People like to change definitions.
Right. So, I can tell you from experience in public school, we are taught that anarchy is synonymous with chaos.
Right.
So where does that leave you?
Yeah, thinking that government is going to save you from the boogeyman, right?
Right.
And what is chaos? I mean, we have that pretty much right now.
Is that this not chaos, right? Out there,
or
in
three
the
people talking to a camera right now. Chaos.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, dogs and cats living together.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm a mathematician. Chaos theory. You know, proper bifurcation leads to appropriate order. It leads to the universe around us, to what we have around us. You know, right. If you look at biology, that is chaos theory. You know, there is a certain bifurcation of the leaves, and chaos is beautiful.
I would call that entropy. That's, you know, natural disorganization. But in terms of, like, in the way that they're saying, like, there's murder and mayhem and destruction, I look at that as that's what you have today with government.
And that's the opposite of anarchy, but people don't realize that. I mean, you have to analyze a word and its roots. I mean, and without rulers, archy, you know. It's without rulers.
Right.
And without archy rulers. Without rulers.
That's probably why they took out Latin and Greek from the...
And you have society that are now using all kinds of words to repurpose them for agendas. Racism, for example. I was told that I can't experience racism because I happen to be Caucasian. That's not the definition of racism. No. Racism is someone believing that they are superior to another person based on race, but you would never picture that because people are changing definitions of words. And that's not the only word that's been changed, but liberal's been changed, progressive's been changed. I mean, all kinds of words are being changed to fit agendas.
Right. Yeah, I think even the word racism and all that stuff is kind of meaningless. It kind of is too vague. I think something more denotes a lot of this other people are advocating for. If you want us to suspect if someone has, it would be racial hatred, right? Do they exhibit racial hatred in terms of advocation of violence towards another person in that sense? The term for terrorism, you know, is defined as the use of violence against persons or property to intimidate or coerce people to further political objectives. That's the definition of government.
I'm a terrorist,
right? Yeah.
Yeah, I'm a terrorist right now because I advocate for political change for the absence of politics.
Oh, that's what they would say, right? Yeah,
I'm a terrorist.
No, that is the definition that is put forth by, you know, the political class.
Right.
Is terrorists are the peaceful. It's peace is war. War is peace.
Right. Yeah. Freedom
is slavery.
So, like, in that sense, anarchists can never be terrorists because it's a non-political position. So it's just the best thing ever. People say, well, I don't want to talk about politics. Great, neither do I. I'm here to talk about freedom, facts, and evidence, right? Politics is the language of slaves. Politics is the language of saying, how much do we borrow from you? How much do we restrict your freedom of movement and what you want to do with your own property, right? Let's tax them this percentage. Let's rob them a little bit from this much over there. And that's when people bring up politics, that's what they talk about. Oh yeah, I could see why you wouldn't want to talk about politics. It's a dirty business of, it's a horrible thing to do, discussing how to violently rule the lives of other people. Another reason why to take up anarchy, it's anti-political, political labels in that sense. But yeah, this is an interesting development. If somebody wants to fund me a trip to go out there, I don't know. Well, I guess I think they have like a very difficult time for people getting up there. It's in the middle of nowhere, right? I think they took over a wildlife park building that was vacant during the holidays. So there's no, there's electricity. The government will just turn that off. So there'll be no electricity.
Yeah, I think they're ready for that.
Yeah, I guess they're ready.
Yeah, I think they're ready for permanent camping.
They said the FBI was looking, and you know, whenever the feds get involved, they kind of do some shady stuff. But I think you're onto something with going on.
I think they're going to set the place on fire.
Well, regardless of what happens, they'll spend it somehow. I mean, just like the Waco incident. I mean, the bikers in Waco, I mean, there's stuff coming out about that they weren't, you know, it was all the feds that did the fire. I mean, there's so many different stories from eyewitnesses, but I mean, you wouldn't know that.
Right.
But I think you're on to something about going up there. And I think that not only this, but the Ferguson incidents, the Baltimore incidents, I think we could definitely spread anarchy that way.
Eventually we'll have to. Yeah.
Because people are fed up with the government. But they see the government as the only choice, but we can educate them that it's not the only choice.
Right.
I mean, we don't have the government in this room right now.
Right. There's no state. There's no government. Right. Yeah. There's no chaos here.
Yeah. I mean...
I'll be your cameraman. I'll go out with you.
Yeah, that'll be a lot of fun.
And I'll be there just to laugh, because I laugh when everyone does stuff.
Hey, you'll offer them a beer and talk about
it. I will offer them a freaking beer. You know what? And if they want to come and arrest me for it, then they can arrest me for it. I'm sure one of the viewers will post bail for me.
Right, absolutely.
But... It's. I think that my main issue with this, and I know it's kind of getting off on a tangent, is we're so divided right now, when we kind of need to unite together and say, hey, government is the cause of all these problems.
Right.
Well, that's Hegelian. I mean, basically, it is really a united or a divided front. I mean, the people are divided because they're easier to conquer.
Right. And, eventually, this will reach down here to Richmond. Originally, we're going to have to do not something like take over a building or anything like that. The plan here is inevitably to build up an anarchist tribe large enough to finally lead to contend with the prison wardens of Richmond, which is a minority, right? These are a very tiny few people who are really violent psychopaths in Richmond. But by that time, once you reach a good large enough community size, large enough tribe, has enough champions of liberty, has real respect for private property, for self-ownership, we can all stop paying, start giving into the fear of what happens if you don't surrender your property to the IRS extortion agencies, for example.
Well, I think that's the best strategy, is a mass peaceful withdrawal.
Right.
And that's really it. You're just withdrawing from the tentacles. You cannot steal from me anymore.
Right.
Well, and the problem is people look at that and they have a problem with that, but I don't understand why they have a problem with that. If I want to be off the grid and I want to live with you three and I'll provide the beer, you provide the food, it doesn't affect anybody else. There's no. I'm not taking their property. I'm not preventing from them. At the least, I'm preventing them from taking my money.
Right.
So I think that's. And I'm hopeful that it's going to happen one day.
It's inevitable. You can either force his hand, right? So this is inevitable. Government's going to collapse inevitable. Secession is inevitable. It happens throughout all of history and doesn't occur very violently, very peacefully, I guess.
Empires fall.
Empires, right. You look at the eastern states of Europe when USSR collapsed, there was no civil war.
Venezuela already ran out of toilet paper.
Right. So secession is inevitable. We can either wait until that occurs and then... get ready for the transition, right? We would have built a large enough tribe to do that, or we can force its hand by all of us together as a community, together unplug the state by not giving up our property to them anymore, and they will suffocate immediately.
Except for the commies.
Except for the commies. Yeah, fuck the commies again.
They've already suffocated.
Yeah. This is the issue of withholding tax, for example. This is something that Milton Friedman is his biggest sin. Father David Friedman was creating the withholding tax, and that there was a problem in which annually, if people were to surrender their property once a year, if they forget the date, the government doesn't have money for all to fund all their monopolies, because people are kind of late in making their payments. So he solved a problem. It's like, well, why don't we create a withholding tax and continue to rob everyone every day, every week, every month for an entire year, and then it's up to you to decide whether we rob too much or too little, right? With no interest. So that's this lifeblood, these taxations, right? This is why Detroit has collapsed, right, inevitably. But you can force his hand into suffocate and asphyxiate very quickly, and there's no more funding for the police extortion. There's no more funding for any of these monopolies, and it collapses. But by that time, we would build a large enough group, a large enough tribe for that transition to just replace everything else privately, right? That has final real respect for the sanctity of ownership, of humanity. So peacefully, a peaceful transition. People will say, well, what if the federal government, the first city that does this, everything else will fall after that. Everything else will fall like dominoes, and the most we can do, of course, is put that spotlight in the sky, and everyone else will say, well, they have a lot of freedom there. We want to do the same thing. If there is contention of people trying to say, well, let's still try to collect this property tax, right, the next day, by that time, we have 5,000 or 10,000 anarchists here, we do something similar like the Bunny Ranch. Yeah, come ahead and take this guy's house. Come ahead and take their car, right? Try to see if you pass all of us, right? And then when the attention finally comes to us, any kind of media attention is like, well, I guess there's no anywhere here of an advocation for the initiation of force. Everything here is talked about peaceful coexistence with everyone, respect for the individual, peaceful parenting.
I hate to play devil's advocate, but they will... That's not the narrative that will be spun.
It'll be too late by the time of the narrative. But even then, even if the narrative will be tried to be spun, the attention will be brought to Liberate RVA. And all they have to do is just check the website. All they have to do is just check the videos.
Yeah, nobody will do that.
All you have to do is, people are looking at this guy. People look up even the Bundy father, and look like he has an interesting past in his description of black people, for example, right? He has some interesting racial stones. They search things up. They search everything here. It's like everything comes out legit.
Well, the positive thing is that the mainstream media is losing more and more traction every day.
Right, which is great. And the bad, and to piggyback off of that, I mean, the bad thing is you can't, it's hard to find an unbiased article.
Right.
I mean, we searched a long time to find an unbiased article on this Oregon deal, because you have some people that are really for it, so they're going to have a slant towards that, and people are really against them calling domestic terrorists and all this other mumbo jumbo, and they're going that way. It's hard to find a well-written article that says, hey, this, and this, but this, and this, because people don't want to play devil's advocate. They always want to be right. And that's what we've turned our political system into, is it's a sports game. You have to win.
Right.
You always have to be right. You're the person you voted for can never be wrong.
But we have, I'll say, 20 years to get this going, to get there, and enough time to develop this show and put a lot of alternative media out there, enough time to build up something substantial of enough weight to contend with the lies that are out there in the mainstream media.
I think 20 years is is optimistic. I would shoot for 5 to 10. But I think we can make it.
I guess right now it would be 15 to 20.
I would say 15 to 20. Pessimistic, maybe?
No, I think.
You think it'll happen before then?
I don't think that the American society as it is going to last that long.
Right.
You know, and call me pessimistic.
Okay, I get what you're saying.
Okay.
Yeah, I think that there's going to be a fall within the next decade, and I realize that's a very a pessimistic outlook, but I don't have bright views.
Right, and I think it's going to start with the currency. I think it's going to start with currency. People are not going to know what to do. And then it's going to be utter chaos, utter anarchy.
Right. People have been talking about the currency thing for a long time now. Doug Casey has been talking about it for like 2 decades now. And it hasn't really occurred yet. You know,
it has occurred. It's just they want to lie to
you. It has occurred.
Right.
But like to the point and brink of like finally the last several percentage points have dropped. Government's going to try to prolong that as long as it can. Like it can.
I think the Doug Casey and Jeff Berwick analysis and even the Schiff analysis. I think those drastically underestimate the population difference between, you know, past occurrences and the United States. I think the population of the United States really requires a much larger cash infusion to really cause this hyperinflation to happen. So I do agree that inflation has been unexpectedly low, and there are probably, you know, things occurring behind the scenes that are causing that to happen. I think in, you know, 2009 we actually had negative inflation. Which is very strange, considering the, you know, 2007-2008, you know, cash infusions from the Fed.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't think that hyperinflation is going to hit us unless they go full potato and say, oh, inflation is really high, we need to start paying our, you know, government employees more and more and more and more and more and more in order to overcome this. And that's really an issue that happens to very, you know, fully government taken over societies. And I think there's a sufficient, you know, political backlash against that type of behavior in America that I don't think it'll happen. I don't think we will see hyperinflation here.
Well, and it's on the same, the Fed, the government, the organization you want on top of your list. They just raise interest rate. How can you raise an interest rate on something that's printed out of thin air? I mean, I'd love to be able to print pieces of paper out and charge you money for printing out pieces of paper.
Right? Realistically, they didn't raise interest rates.
Well, right.
I mean, they raised it 0.25%. You know, that it's so minuscule. You know, as even if you look back on history, you know, in the 80s, interest rates were in what, the 10s and 20s. You know, and that's the federal or the you know, federal funds rate.
Mm-hmm.
Which is, so I think their move was more of at most a positioning.
I would say it's more of an artificial acknowledgement that the economy's getting better, because it's not. But they want you to think that it's getting better.
Yeah.
So when interest rates are raised, then it makes you think that I mean, look at the Dow. I think today it opened at the lowest that it's opened in the longest time.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I
mean,
well, it's a, you know, unemployment went down. Don't look at the workforce participation. Unemployment went down. Don't look at the workforce, you know. So, yeah, it was absolutely a, you know, see what we did worked, I promise.
Yeah.
And now we can go back to the way things were-ish.
Believe in us again. Have faith in us again.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Something, a sleight of hand distraction. Like everything government does, goes smoke some mirrors. Yeah, I mean, this is a situation out there. It's interesting. Things that we can kind of take lessons for, just like the Bunny Ranch and stuff. And it goes to show that people will volunteer.
Right.
Right. And the argument that people went out there that, you know, these people were cattle ranching this lands for a long time and trying to show, like, you know, that's the history of, like, the not-so-wild West, you know. It wasn't that wild. You know, people went out there with contracts with respect for private property. And that's why there was a lot of less violence out there that occurred in a lot of these communities, in minor ranching communities and cattle ranching communities. There's like the most were like maybe two people murdered. I mean, if you were to shoot the innkeeper, good luck finding someone with all the network connections to bring all these goods out in the middle of nowhere. So
there's good and bad stuff to take from this.
Yeah, 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 yeah. And hopefully, I mean, that's the thing out there, right? Until they've been presented a complete picture of what's going on, the only thing that they know is what they grew up with, what they've been indoctrinated with, that whatever the problem, you either have option A of government or option B, still more government. No one's ever been presented there with option C. How about none of the above? All right. So I can't really judge it that harshly, but most like everyone else, right? These people could be future anarchists. So, yeah, I guess we'll see how that develops, and I guess we'll continue to cover that.
Yeah. Be good.
Amen. So I guess we have another interesting government threat.
So I'm passionate about this, obviously, because it's beer-related. I know I figured my first contribution to this would be beer-related. So I'm going to read the article headline here. FDA requiring nutrition labels on craft beer, deadline next December. So basically, the new regulations will require breweries to list nutritional content if they want to keep serving their suds at chain restaurants and brew pubs. This is the U.S. Food and Drug Administration that's going to require this. You may not think this is a big deal. However, the problem is it's going to cost these breweries, these small breweries, $500 to $1,000 per type of beer. So this particular beer right here, this is a Yinling, this would cost $500 to $1,000. If you're big on the beer scene like I am, you have a lot of craft beers, they come up with new wacky ideas, it's going to cost them to do so. And they have to put a label on this now. The $500 to $1,000 is going to basically analyze what's in the beer, determine calorie count and whatnot.
So what you're saying is this is going to add a prohibitive price tag to innovation.
Correct. So it's gonna help big organizations like Anheuser-Busch, but it's going to hurt local breweries. The problem with this, the craft brewers are, hey, we have full transparency. We're good with this. Not good with the nutrition labels, but we're good with, we already list our ingredients on a board behind us. You know, if you're that concerned, ask us. You know,
yeah.
We don't have to pay extra. And I think the problem is people don't realize that in addition to the $500 to $1,000 that it costs to do this, they have to change their labeling, so they may have to buy a two-labeler system where they have to put a label on the back. And I think the regulation requires it to be on the back. So it's going to cost them a bit of money that they don't have. I mean,
right.
This really stifles local businesses. I mean, my theory is if you don't want to buy something, then don't buy it. If I say, hey, what's in this, and it lists an ingredient that I don't want, then I'm not going to force you to not make it that way or tell me what's in it. I just won't buy it.
Yeah.
Well, this comes into play with GMO labeling, labeling and kosher labeling. You know, if somebody says they're kosher, you can look that up. And if somebody says they're non-GMO, you can look that up elsewhere. And you can make sure, as a conscientious consumer, that you are not getting a GMO product.
Right.
What this comes down to is it's major corporations that are losing money. I mean, the craft, if you don't follow beer, I apologize because it's a great thing to follow. But if you don't follow craft beer, it's just not your taste. It's killing these major corporations' profits. And that's fine. It's all about capitalism. But when you use those to circumvent the law and make your profit better based on federal law. I mean, that's a problem.
Right.
And they're losing so much money to these craft breweries that I think that they're reaching now to say, hey, what can we do to hurt the little guy? You know, they're using the government forcing at gunpoint to basically say, hey, you know, you have to do this now, and it's costing people money.
Right.
Well, that's the thing about this bullshit liberal mentality that regulations are going to be helping people. But no, regulations are destroying small businesses. It's destroying people who are coming up to take these giant corporations out of business. These people are competing these corporations out of business. But you want to put regulations forth to squash them and give your so hated corporations carte blanche over these people.
Well, that's the major problem I had with the Occupy Wall Street movement, is that they were focusing on corporations, but they weren't focused on the root cause, which was government.
Yeah.
I mean, when you have a corporation, basically a corporation is a government entity. Without government, you wouldn't have corporations.
Right.
A corporation is basically a business that is free of liability.
Right.
So if you sell me a bad product, you're not liable, but your company is. No, you should be liable.
My sock puppet is.
Right, yeah. Right. Yeah, no, this guy over here that I just happen to have a license for that I paid a bunch of money for.
Right.
We won't even get into the amount of money that it costs to have a legitimate brewery. I mean, it's $5,000 to $10,000, which is a lot of money for a small person like myself if I wanted to open a brewery.
There was a report that came out at terrorizing.com in which they were analyzing the number of regulations that came out in the past three decades. So the past 60 years worth of all the regulations that came out there in the market have made you 75% poorer as a result. Because all this stuff adds up. All these building codes adds up. That's not up to code. You need to change that. Well, yeah, this is not up to our standard. You need to pay more for this. You know, of course, the government has their arbitrary rates in which how much it would cost for you to get insurance, for example. All this stuff adds up, and which is why, of course, when it's so much, it's very difficult for them to hire new people, for them to expand, for them to pay you more, pay themselves more, and to grow and develop. It's kind of like, another way of Ayn Rand saying, like, one of the most targeted minorities, the most crucified minority is the businessman. Of course, we put a mention in there as it's children. Second, the businessman. That's horrific. That's horrific. That affects everybody. And they're always put out to be the boogeyman in that regard.
And you know, $500 to $1,000 doesn't seem like a lot to people listening, but I don't have $500 or $1,000. I mean, if you have to look at these craft beers, the things that they're doing, I mean, they're coming out with new beers. We have a local brewery that came with the gingerbread stout. You never heard of that before, but now I get to try it. It's delicious. It is absolutely delicious. And they may be okay, but if Joe Schmo's brewery over here wants to do something innovative, now they have to pay $500 to $1,000 on top of their additional investment in order to do this beer. That's not only going to prevent them from doing different beers or not willing to try different things, but it's going to cost you more at the pump, as I say,
right.
More at the pump. But not only is this happening, but I want to touch on a different thing that's happening. InBev is a big organization out of, I believe, Belgium that bought Anheuser-Busch. And they're doing a lot of lobbying to allow legislation in order to further their business. So basically what they're doing is they have a distribution. They're paying beer distributors basically a royalty if you carry 98% of their beers. Okay, that's capitalism. Okay, you made enough money. The problem is that we have a three-tier system in our government. Since the Prohibition times, which was the 1920s. So you have Prohibition now. They have a three-tier alcohol system. So it says that you have to have a maker, which is your brewery, a distributor, which is another middleman, and then a retailer. So I have to basically, if I want to sell to you, I have to give it to him, and then he can sell it to you. So normally it wouldn't be a problem to say, hey, this company's done a lot of money. Here's a whole bunch of money and you can help a product. But the problem is they don't have an option to go anywhere else. They can't distribute out of their own brewery. Mm-hmm. So what InBev is doing is they are paying distribution companies up to $200,000 a year in order to carry 98% of their profits. And they don't have enough warehouse space. So they're like, all right, well, this small local business, we're going to go ahead and push aside. They're no longer on our distribution route. We're going to do 98% of this company. Well, the problem with that is that little company that got pushed aside has to have a distribution. They can't go to the bar down the street and sell them their beer directly. They have to go through a three-tier system. So I think to touch on that is now you have a corporation that's taking advantage of federal law in order to make capital gain.
Right.
So what you have, and we see this a lot. We see a lot of government subsidies, government grants in order to help businesses, but it really hurts other businesses right. trying to compete. We can look at this with the auto bailout.
You can look at it at Stone Park Brewery.
Right. And that's my greatest thing against Stone. And I love beer, but I'm having a hard time going to Stone because they're getting all this money to open a brewery here. But what about the little guys that started
it? Right.
And it's like the car bailouts. You had Chevy get a bailout. Well, Ford didn't take a bailout. Well, Ford didn't take a bailout because they made good business decisions where the Chevy didn't, but Chevy's rewarded with the bailout. And it's not entirely sure if they even paid it back, but regardless if they did pay it back, they're basically getting a taxpayer loan.
Right.
And this is essentially what's happened with the beer market. And obviously, I'm passionate about
the beer market. Yeah, absolutely, so absolutely, absolutely. Yeah, that's the unseen. That's the unseen beer breweries that are not being developed now because of the money is being siphoned and taken away to go to government favored, you know, puppets that they'd rather, you know, cater to instead. It reminds me of like the vehicles, for example, right? So there's the Automotive Cartel Association, in which, for example, Tesla vehicles want to send out their vehicles. They want to sell their cars, their energy battery-powered cars of the future. However, a lot of the cartels, these automobile cartels, are trying to say, well, you cannot sell them outside of our own distribution. You have to go to the automobile dealership to do so. So there's a lot of problem here in Virginia, for example, in Nova, because Tesla wants to go just directly from, here's my car, I want to bypass everyone else and just give it to you, right? That's their model. They're trying to bypass everything else. We don't want to go through the automotive dealership cartel because it costs a lot of money.
Yeah.
In a way, it's kind of like Bitcoin. But Bitcoin's like, you disregard the third party of banks and you just deal Bitcoin directly with me and the recipient, right? But yeah, these are cartels. These are all the added layers of costs. I mean, what we're talking about to everyone.
And with the car market, I think they said you if you didn't have to deal with a dealership, you would save an average of $1,200 to $1,800 per vehicle. So imagine the cost of beer, maybe $1 a bottle, and $1 a bottle is a lot.
It's a long way.
I mean, it's just $1, but you should never force a business to go through someone else, a middleman, to go to someone else, and this was a prohibition-era law. I mean,
right. Prohibition hasn't ended.
It really hasn't. Right. We have prohibition not only on... We still have a prohibition on alcohol.
Right.
Regardless of what people think. I mean, you know, some places you have a state ABC board, alcohol beverage control, that controls a monopoly on liquor, so they can raise their prices to $30, $40 for a 750 milliliter bottle when you can go to a state that doesn't require a government and they can compete with each other. But the right. government doesn't like competition.
No.
They don't like theft because they don't like competition.
Right.
And all the while being the monopoly there, the government enforced monopoly, they say, thank you for your business.
Oh, I hate that. I hate that. ABC, yeah. It's like, thank you for your patronage. Thank you for your business. Well, like, I didn't have a choice. I can't go anywhere else.
And they don't even listen to their own laws. I caught them out on Facebook. They posted a Black Friday sale.
Right.
They posted a Black Friday sale where a bar couldn't do that in the state of Virginia, mm-hmm. at least. They couldn't do that. However, they were allowed to do it, and I called them out, and they said, well, it's okay. There's no law written about spirits. Well, they're the only people that can sell spirits. How right. convenient.
Yeah.
How convenient
a
for you.
A bar cannot even advertise their specials of what kind of beer on their own website.
No. And they have to buy all their liquor from the ABC store.
Right.
They don't even have it delivered to them. They have to go to the ABC store. They have to buy it. They have to make sure that there are little tax stamps on the bottom.
Right.
And it's absolutely ridiculous, and I know... A lot of people think that beer is petty and alcohol is petty, but as far
Everyone
as being
devices.
Government control, but that is mine. I love beer. Beer is my passion, and the fact that the government is involved in my passion pisses me off.
Vices are not crimes, right?
No, there's no victim, no crime.
Yeah. It reminds me of a situation of Hardy Park Brewery. You've been there, right?
Where at?
Hardy Park Brewery?
Hardywood, yeah.
Hardywood, yeah. I'm yep. sorry, yeah. Hardywood. We're going to go there. Awesome place.
That's
awesome
a great time. Place.
So there's a situation that occurred about 2 years ago, I believe, in which the city council was, well, they went up to and said, hey, we're going to open up a brewery here. And they say, all right, well, you know, you're not selling any food. It's like, yeah, no, just beer. It's like, all right, well, I guess meal tax doesn't apply to you. And then it's like, all right, great. Awesome. Good to go. Good to know. And then a year later, the city council said, we changed our mind. Beer is a meal. You owe us money. Thousands and thousands of dollars.
They tried to back tax them.
Right? Yeah. Well, wait a minute. A year later, tens of thousands of dollars. That's tens of thousands of dollars that could have gone to hire a new employee, right? There's a lot of awesome things you could do with beer and research assistance in terms of creating good beer or expansions or lowering the price. And of course, those tens of thousands of dollars goes to somebody sitting at City Hall whose job it is to rob from other people. They're not out there creating any value. Their job is to rob the value that other people are creating just so they can sit in their office and sustain their lifestyle and theft. And that's what occurred. I don't remember what ended up happening after that, or if they were able to.
They actually got out of that. They are getting a government grant to open a brewery in Goochland.
There you go.
However, I'm still going to drink there. You can't fault them for taking advantage of people giving you money. I mean, I understand what we need to do, but they're getting so many attacks. They're moving to Goochland. They're getting, you know, it's still a great brewery. I just think that when you have the government involved in capitalism, it really hurts other local businesses. Yeah. There's a lot of breweries. We're lucky in Richmond to have a lot of breweries. So they are getting hurt for this one organization.
Right.
One thing I will say, however, is as far as that goes, is so right now when you go to a brewery, you have a lot of food trucks. Well, a food truck tried to open up a permanent establishment in Hardywood to serve food, and the ABC said they couldn't because they had to have a different licensing to serve food. And we had a bar lose their ABC license, Wonderland, because they didn't sell enough food to alcohol ratio.
Right.
Enough food to alcohol ratio. And me as a patron, I mean, they're going to a bar to, I don't know about you, I don't go to bars to eat. I mean, I'll go to Applebee's to eat. I'll go to a Chili's to eat. Yeah. I'm going to a bar to freaking get my drink on.
I have never once ordered food at Fallout.
Right?
Really? But their beer, you know what? I will say they have excellent food.
They do have good
food. And I have ordered the food from them. But I go to a bar to drink.
Technically, there are no bars.
Right.
There's only restaurants.
Yeah, there's only restaurants. And the sad thing is 40% of the sales have to be food. What if I don't want to? I mean, that's basically, when you require an establishment to serve 40% worth of food, I can't control what people are going to, what am I going to say? No, you can't order that beer because we haven't met our food quota.
Right.
Yeah.
How about just, what's the difference in me ordering a thing of tater tots once a month and drinking a ton of beer? There's literally nothing but control, fines, which gain money, and basic controls over establishments.
Well, right. I think by and large that actually forces perjury. Because
You have to lie.
Yeah.
I definitely would. If I was smart, I mean, it does force perjury.
There's one restaurant that tried to go very legit about this and tried to say, well, let's give this a try and see if we can go legit. And turned out they couldn't. They couldn't do the ratio. And they were fined. And it's like, you shouldn't have told them the truth. Why would you? The government never told you the truth on their own end.
What would hurt if I sold 100% alcohol and no food? It's literally, it's nothing but games. It's about licensing. It's like, we can extort this much money.
And they want the money. It pockets them. You know, they don't want to make that car payment. You know, that house payment. You know, they got kids to feed at your expense.
Yeah, this goes into the three felonies a day issue.
Oh yeah,
where it's basically impossible to live your life without committing a felony. Yeah, and the reason they do this is because they want a situation where they can get you for something. They don't want you to be innocent.
Right.
Everybody's guilty of something, whether it's a crime or not.
Right. It's like that meme in terms of there's a cop saying, well, I earned my pay. It's like a slave owner saying, I earned my cotton. These licenses agencies, the ABC folks that go out, these code enforcers, well, you know, that's where they do it. They need to get that money.
You have any idea how much energy it requires in my right arm to whip those slaves every day?
Right. Man. But I think it's very good that we draw a lot of attention to this. Like, we're talking about subsidization and stuff like that, but there's a lot of unawareness that goes around in terms of overlooking these sort of matters, right? There's a lot of media outlets that don't look at this stuff objectively. So until, of course, these breweries start seeing for what it is, maybe they can start doing better decisions in the future towards that. Because for the most part, nobody knows.
Right, and that's part of what I want to do, you know? I mean, we all have our passions,
right?
And as soon as you have someone else saying that, hey, this affects your passion, I would love nothing more to open a brewery, but it costs too much,
right?
And it's not because it costs too much capital; it's licensing fees, taxation that prevents me from being a middle class person from opening my dream job of opening a brewery.
Right.
It is remarkably inexpensive to open a business.
Oh, it,
anywhere.
Right, but you have to have
the licensing. The expense is the licensing. and the government controls, and all of that, all of those little things that they try to extract from you, that is what makes opening a business and starting your own, you know, becoming financially independent so difficult.
Right. Well, and then you have the status argument that, well, you basically, you need to ask permission to work here because you were born here. I don't know about you, I was born on a piece of land. I was born in Virginia.
I think which I was is a little place too called young Virginia. To sign anything.
Yeah, I never signed anything. Why can't I give you a beer in exchange for Bitcoin?
Right.
Or why can't I give you a beer in exchange for food? Or why can't I do this or that? Why do we have to have a middleman saying you can't do this? Because it's all about revenue.
Right.
If they don't get their hand in the honeypot, then they're pissed off. And,
right.
And people don't realize that. And the common argument that pisses me off the most, and I know everybody's heard it, is, well, if you don't like it, you can leave. Well, why should I leave?
Why should I leave?
I'm not the bully. If I come into your playground and says you can't slide on this slide because I'm a fat guy, because I'm fat? No.
Yeah.
How about I can do whatever I want as long as I don't affect you?
How about the those who advocate for theft and murder and the enslavement of peaceful people leave, right? Civilization belongs to the civilized, right? Not to the barbarians. Right? If you don't like it, why don't you leave? You're the one who's advocating murder and theft. Cajun peaceful people. Get the hell out of here. This is not your city.
No, it's not theft. It's taxation.
Oh, it's taxation. It's a different word. Yeah.
It's all kinds of words.
Right?
Yeah, proper definitions.
It's right. Not a marijuana. It's not a marijuana. It's sick of weed.
Right.
You know, yeah.
It's only sick of weed in Colorado and Washington. And the rest of America, it's pot,
yeah,
and it's
who,
bad.
Who says I don't, and I don't even smoke weed, but who says I don't live in Colorado? I mean, are we just going to draw a line? I mean, I can make a map and draw imaginary lines on it
right.
All day long. I can make Liberate every land. I'd love to do that, actually. You guys are welcome to be there, no rulers.
Yeah, you assholes get to gerrymander, why can't I?
Right?
Yeah. This little piece, this is Colorado now.
It's like that Family Guy episode where he made Pretoria, where he realized there wasn't an area on his map. That wasn't claimed by the U.S., so he started his own country.
the Liberland thing out there. What's going to happen? It's like, you're in the middle of this dispute. They're going to kick you out eventually.
Well, regardless, if we do start our own country, I will supply the beer.
Absolutely.
I will supply the coffee.
The revolution will be high on on beer and wired on coffee.
I'll do the uppers, you do the downers.
Yeah,
I love this.
Start with you and with me. You know, and then we pass out and do it all over again without taxation.
Every day.
Perfect.
And tons of representation.
Absolutely.
All right, so this is my passionate issue for the day. Crowd-funded Star Trek film Axanar sued by CBS and Paramount for copyright infringement. According to court documents filed on Wednesday, the suit pertains to the unauthorized exploitations of Star Trek, quote-unquote, filed against Axanar Productions Incorporated and producer Alec Peters for both Axanar and its already-made prequel Prelude to Axanar. The action further states these films infringe plaintiffs' quote-unquote works by using innumerable copyrighted elements of Star Trek, including its settings, characters, species, and themes.
Oh my god.
So I don't know about any other Star Trek fans out there, but I personally will not pay for the next Star Trek movie or the next Star Trek series if they continue with this lawsuit.
Hear, hear.
Because I will boycott them and pirate their work, but I will boycott them financially, and I will not support them if they're doing this. Historically, Paramount has been great about supporting and staying away, not suing fan films, fan fiction, fan comics, you know, whatever. But now, Axanar has actually been very successful in what they're doing, and they have, you know, they have built a film that is arguably actually more compelling than the recent movies that Paramount has put, that J.J. Abrams has been working on. Mm-hmm. And now that they've been actually drawing so much attention, they actually had a Kickstarter that made $1 million, and now that they're drawing so much attention, now CBS and Paramount wants to shut them down because they're doing better.
Right.
They're making better stories. And they even have actors from past Paramount and CBS Star Trek films. They have Tony Todd, who is in multiple, he played multiple characters, including Worf from Next Generation, his brother. He played Worf's brother. He played Jake Sisko, aged Jake Sisko in Deep Space Nine. He played in countless other characters. J.G. Hertzler, which was a huge character in Deep Space Nine, he is involved in Axanar. Both of these people are involved in this film. It has been doing really great. And in the past, you know, Star Trek fan films have been just terrible, you know, bad acting, bad costuming, bad graphics. But Axanar has actually brought it to modern, you know, modern filmmaking techniques. The acting has been phenomenally better than past fan films. The production values, the graphics have been phenomenal. The costuming is better. And the costuming is one thing specifically that I really, you know, make a big fuss about old fan films. They've actually done a terrific job, and now CBS and Paramount are trying to shut them down.
Now I want to watch some of this stuff.
I think honestly we should distribute it. I mean, this is great. The thing that I got a kick out of, I know I laughed about it, was species. So I know they use the term human in Star Trek.
Right.
So am I allowed to say human or Earth? That's what I want to know. I don't want to get sued by Paramount. Am I allowed to say I live on the planet Earth or Terra? Am I allowed to say I'm a human? Because at this point,
I think that's actually copyrighted by Greenpeace, so you'll have to.
Okay. Yeah. Well, no, they're too busy destroying the lines in Peru. But
right.
I'm with you on this. This is absolutely ridiculous.
Yeah.
And they're not even making, I think we were talking before this, they're not even making a profit. They're all non-profit, right?
Right. So the argument is that their books aren't completely public. So it might be that some people are making money. So some of the actors might be making money. And some of the production people might be
making
money.
But that's not the film making money, because you have to pay for it. I mean, even non-profit organizations make money to pay for...
Right. So the Kickstarter is to pay for the production of the actual film.
Right.
So the production company itself is not actually making money.
I'm going to take a break for 1 second. Back from the break. Had to replace the battery. We're very passionate about our subjects.
Get more beer.
Yeah. But yeah, I guess in that regard, there's one word that always kind of that bothers me here, the unauthorized exploitation. All right? It's like, how do you define that exploitation part of that?
Yeah.
Very commie language, very vague, very difficult to interpret it. You know, and that's always something you always want to do when someone brings that up. It's like, well, define exploitation, right?
I think exploitation in general, when you actually look at the definition of it, is a good thing. I think exploitation is a positive value. You exploit your resources in order to live, in order to, you know, enhance your life.
I've never heard of that part. I kind of like that.
Yeah. It's sort of a Randian view.
Profit itself is not a dirty word, right? So like they say they were non-profits, like go ahead and be a prophet. Everybody profits. If you don't profit, you die, right? If you don't trade with somebody else, you both profit. Otherwise, you wouldn't be involved in that exchange.
Yeah. The fact that we are supporting, or not we, but the general consensus is supporting an organization that can basically take your money over words. I can make up a word, Jalukovin, and if you ever use that word, then I can take thousands and thousands of dollars from you.
Taylor Swift! She copyrights Party Like It's 1989. She didn't even come up with that phrase.
She was born in
1989. She copied it from Prince, but somehow she thinks that she has the right to the trademark of Party Like It's 1989.
Disney's even worse. I mean, the current copyright laws were supposed to end, and they were like, magically, they just lobbied to make some Mickey Mouse. You can't put a Mickey Mouse logo up there. Right. A mouse.
Right.
A mouse. So if a mouse runs across my wall...
One big ball and two small balls.
You can't do that. No, not at all. I mean, don't forget Paris Hilton was trying to copyright That's Hot, or You're Hot. Yeah. And if you want to know another reason why... Trump, another reason not to like the guy, he was trying to, I think, believe copyright You're Fired. Yeah. Right? That was his trademark thing.
I'm going to copyright Liberate RVA. Oh, so every time you face this code, you're going to have to pay me a royalty. I'm just saying. I mean, you know, because that's the type of person I am.
Ridiculous. Have you ever heard of, there's a guy, you guys have heard of Instagram. Everyone has, right?
Yeah,
there's a guy who had a website called Sluts of Instagram. and they were sent a message to cease and desist, stop what you're doing. It had nothing to do with sluts. It had to do, or pictures or thereof. It just had to do with this fantastical story of a goose named Slutsov from Instagram.
Come on, we have to laugh about this stuff. Our society.
Right.
I mean, the fact that you can literally lead an argument with, you cannot use species. Species, really? Now you're going to copyright a word, Klingon? I can't speak Klingon because, you know... And I'm a big Trekkie. I love Star Trek, but this makes me...
Don't cling on me.
Yeah, don't cling on me. To piggyback off of Star Wars, looking for love in Alderaan places. I mean, you know, I don't know. If I created a film, I would be flattered that people were doing this, you know?
Yeah.
I'm already a multi-billion-dollar corporation. Don't really need that much more.
It brings a lot of attention. Right. There's a lot of fan service there. Right?
In fact, if you do a good enough job, I may hire you.
Right.
No, it's all about theft and jealousy. That's all it is. It's theft, you're making money, I want some of that cash. And jealousy, you're making a better story than I am.
Yeah, sorry we haven't done anything with Star Trek. You know? Yeah. Sorry we haven't done anything good. Decent
for, you know, and... Don't get me wrong. I love the J.J. Abrams Star Trek films, but they are not Star Trek. They are action films with the Star Trek name.
And we won't get into Enterprise, the TV show.
I'm
a Next Generation fan, yeah. So...
Well, I am you. Too, but I actually really enjoyed Enterprise. I actually really liked it. I hated the series finale. It was terrible.
It was the intro song that did it for me.
No, it did. No, that actually cut me off, too. I was completely cut off to that. I agree.
Is that gotta have space. 90210 in space?
Pretty much. That was what the intro
did. Intro made it to be kind of like that.
Yeah. The Next Generation the Cards intro is what did it. Space the Final Frontier. I mean, well, it wasn't his intro, but the, I don't know, his voice or something. He just, even though he's a big freaking
but
socialist.
If you just, so here's my advice. Torrent the entire series of Enterprise, because the torrents cut out the actual intro music and they just have it as a separate
video. Nice.
So you can skip the intro and just watch the episode, and it's way more compelling if you don't have to sit through that crappy song.
So Pirate Bay and Chill.
Right.
Pirate Bay and Chill.
Perfect.
I guess the one I'm looking forward to, I guess, would be Galaxy Quest. They're going to make a second movie of it.
Are they really?
Yes.
I haven't heard of that. I'm actually kind of looking forward to Rogue One. I'm a big Star Wars fan. Honestly, I like what J.J. did with the new one. Rogue One's the new Star Wars film.
Is that the one that's based on...
basically, when they're going before the Death Star, they get the plans to the Death Star. I think it takes place before A New Hope.
Sounds like it's based on the N64
game.
Rogue Squadron.
Well, no, it either takes place before A New Hope or Return of the Jedi. I think it takes place before New Hope. It's where they get the plans to the Death Star. Hopefully Darth Vader makes a cameo.
Okay, so it's between episode 3
and it's not J.J. Abrams. It's a different... But the plan is for... I know we're getting off on a tangent, but it's nerd. We have to talk about it. You have Rogue One, then they're going to come out with Star Wars Episode 8, and then they're going to come out with another one that I believe is either about Han Solo or Boba Fett.
Yeah, I know they're planning a series of movies about Boba Fett, and they're planning at least one movie, possibly a TV show, possibly a series of movies about young Han Solo.
Right.
So it's Disney. They're milking it for all they can.
And you know what? I was honestly waiting for them to come out with a whole new world or some song to the new Star Wars, because you know Disney tends to screw up stuff. Although I am a big Pirates of the Caribbean fan.
I'm a big fan of the first one.
Well, yeah. But imagine if we wanted to make a Star Wars theme. I mean, Disney's a horrible corporation.
So LucasArts has always been really good about fan service for Star Wars, like fan fiction and things like that. They've actually been really supportive of the fan fiction community and the fan film community. And I'm not so sure Disney will keep that up. I think if they know what's good for them, they will. Because that is part of what has kept both Star Wars and Star Trek really going, is the fan fiction behind it. People really propping up the quote-unquote IP.
As much as I hate the Disney Corporation, they are making a Star Wars land in Disney World. Yeah. I had to take my girlfriend to Harry Potter Land, so I'll be damned if I'm not going to Star Wars Land.
You have some of that.
I will drink a beer in Mos Eisley.
Was it butter? Butter beer?
I did have some butter beer. It was actually pretty good after I rode my broom in Quidditch. But I will definitely drink a beer in a cantina. You know, I may have
Richmond a lightsaber. Richmond has a Quidditch team.
Do they really?
Yeah.
Huh. And now we need a lightsaber battle team, and I'll be damned. So if you're looking for a lightsaber battle team and you need a nice fat Jedi, I'm good to go, man. Yeah, I'm good to go. I'll provide beer.
There we go.
My grad school NAU had a Quidditch team. They met every week, I think.
Oh yeah.
And you would walk in. People who didn't know what was going on would walk by and just see people running around with brooms and wonder what the hell is going on.
And the sad thing is in today's society, you'd be sued over that. But I honestly don't think she would. I don't think J.K. Rowling would sue over that. I think that she gets a kick out of that stuff, and you know.
Well, that's because she's not dead yet, and she hasn't sold it to Disney yet. So,
man, I don't.
Gene Roddenberry is dead.
Right.
So,
if I started a company, I would be flattered if people copied my work.
Right, and if you can make it better,
then that's great.
Right, there's nothing stolen.
You can't steal something that's from the mind. You can only improve on it. I mean, or make it worse in some cases. I mean, we've seen Bernie Sanders' tweets. I mean, he doesn't exactly.
I don't know what's going on there.
Dude, there's nothing but improvement that you can do to this.
But I mean, the fact that I get in this argument all the time about intellectual property, well, they shouldn't be able to steal my idea. Well, they're not really stealing their idea. First off, it's not your property. It's a thought process. I can reverse engineer your property and make it better, you should be like, well, damn, that's going to make me want to make it better. It only increases competition. It's kind of like I'm a computer PC gamer, right? You have Intel and AMD. Man, you have people fight over Intel and AMD, but they're both important because they both drive them to make better profit or better products. And I mean, this is ridiculous. I mean,
well, intellectual property is by definition anti-competitive,
right?
And that's, I mean, really, what is intellectual property? It is property over intellect, over what is in other people's heads.
The right.
How can you claim that?
The idea that you have a right to other people's money.
Right.
it's laziness. It's people who say, well, I made this one thing. I don't want people to use their own resources and copy or mimic or improve upon it. If you try to do it, I'm going to rob from you. I'm going to use the government thugs to do that. Same thing with patents. Same thing with where you have copyrights, you have patents. There's the third one. What am I missing?
Trademark.
Yeah, provisional patents too. But that's, you know, I mean, you ever watched the show Shark Tank? Where they're like, do you have a patent on it? If they don't, they don't fund it. Well, I wouldn't fund it either if any Joe Schmo could do it.
Right.
You know, just because you came up with this cool idea, then I'd be like, huh, that's a really cool idea, but I'm going to add a light to it.
Right.
So I'm going to make it better.
These days you have to have a patent, or you're going to have some troll coming at you. Because, you know, he has some generic, you know, open ambient idea that fits what you're describing.
Right. I think they're like Tesla. The automotive business, though, release all their patents for everyone to just be able to copy, so they can drive more market competition.
You know what? If I could afford a Tesla, I would definitely buy one. Right. But the fact that and I don't even know whether, I mean, they're probably expensive because they make a hell of a profit product. But
I will state right now, when SpaceX, goes against Virgin Space or Virgin Galactic, I'm going SpaceX because I'm a big fan of. You know, even though, yes, he has his little side projects with government funding, that upsets me. But to a certain extent, it's like, well,
I would just be worried that the rocket would blow up, man. It's happened, what, twice now that SpaceX has done something that's blown up in Virginia?
Virgin, too.
Has it?
Yeah.
Well, I think it'd be awesome to do a podcast from space. Let's say in 30 years, we're going to do a podcast in space.
We will. When we abolish the state. We abolish the state. The future, the news from underground will be on one of the moons of Saturn,
and then they'll text that too.
They'll try to text.
Well, no,
and broadcasting live.
What's his name? Elon Musk. Elon Musk has stated that he supports anarchism too. So he has actually come forth as a, you know, sort of wishy-washy, admittedly, but he says, you know, I kind of support anarchism. And, you know,
because it makes sense.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
Well, I mean,
it's the only thing that makes
sense. It's kind of like you have the continent of Antarctica where no government can claim it or whatever, but I can't go there and visit it because as soon as you visit there, the military there is like, oh, you can't come on Antarctica.
Yeah.
So are we settling this as a status thing? Are we not? Why am I not free to go there? You know, it's a bunch of different things, and you know, we're getting off the tangent of intellectual.
It's a rival gang turf. You know, they have nobody sets up here.
It's too cold for me to claim it, but I'm not going to let you claim it either.
Right. If you want to know the reason why you should hate IP, the reason why Fallout has not come up with the new game in such a long time was because of IP reasons, in terms of copyright lawsuits with one of their, I guess, the original company that owned the name.
Bethesda owns it now.
Right.
And then previous company, I guess, owned it.
I believe it, yeah.
I think Bethesda
yeah.
only did 3 and above.
Right. Mm-hmm. So yeah. They were embroiled in a long lawsuit, and so they couldn't really develop. They could work on it, but they couldn't really release anything or go seriously. More into that.
And let's face it, Bethesda did a lot better job
than the
previous
yeah.
company.
Yeah, it was Interplay before.
Interplay, okay, there you go. Okay. So it's like even the name. In terms of that, and so yeah, I think that's also what's been withholding it from, I guess, inevitably developing into like one of those world massive online RPG games or something like that.
Yeah, they actually tried that, and what ended up happening was a third party that was completely, you know, removed had to do a sort of Fallout like universe, and they released that as a sort of MMO RPG.
Hmm. And I mean, another IP thing. I mean, I play a lot of computer games. I play Battlefront, which is the Star Wars Battlefront. It's a horrible game, but it's Star Wars.
All right.
And I enjoy playing it. But imagine if another company besides EA could step in and do this game. I mean,
all right.
The possibilities are... I mean, I like Bethesda's work. I really do. I think they make a hell of a good games. I wasn't... And I know a lot of people are going to hate that. I wasn't a big fan of Fallout 4 because I thought it was a lot like Fallout 3. I was hoping for something different.
It is very
the dog kind of pissed me off setting off mines while I'm trying to stick around.
You got
to
keep them in your house.
Yeah.
But, you got to play the infiltrator, man.
Yeah, you know. But imagine if we could just do away with this concept of IP and the amount of... I mean, the iPad, for example, I mean, it would probably be tenfold better right now if another company could harvest that technology.
Yeah, well,
but they
even
have
within the current paradigm, so the iPad comes out and Samsung almost immediately comes out with something better. You know, the Samsung, the Galaxy Pad was actually really good, and they had their more customizable interface and everything. And now what is the case now is you have your crappy Windows pads that nobody cares about because they suck, and you have Samsung and Mac arguing over various IP disputes because half of the components in Mac are made by Samsung.
Hmm. Well,
and
I have a Samsung phone. They kind of pissed me off because they went to my old thing for switching to Android, because I was an Apple guy for the longest time, is they had an external battery that I could replace. Well, then they wanted to be more like the iPhone and give me some options, people. Like
right.
You're right now, you're focusing on one market. Give me an option, because I may not like A when I can go to B.
Mm-hmm.
And you're exactly right. I mean, I remember that they said that that something looked too much like their product. I think it was either Apple said Samsung looked too much like their product, or Samsung said that Apple looked too much like their product. Who cares?
You know what that means? That means they think that the consumer are stupid, right? So that's all insult. For consumerism. It's like, I can't tell the difference. I can't make my own choices. I can't go to Consumer Reports. I can look at some of the information here and make my own judgment. That's why a lot of people will, like, I remember coming to a winery, making that excuse, like, yeah, you know, we got to do it because somebody might have copied, you know, the same name. It's like, are you saying that I'm too stupid to figure out whether or not this wine came from you or not?
Yeah.
Right. I mean, that's what it means. It's like, well, it looks too similar. So, what do I care? I think I can figure out the difference between the two.
There are one or two cases there. Either you assume the consumer is too stupid to tell the difference between your product and the imposer's product, or your product is completely, you know, non-differentiable.
Right. Do something about that.
Right.
Yeah, there's an insult for that. And that's something people have to remember. There's ideas are not property, right? I mean, somebody stole my idea, well... All right, well, when was the last time you saw that idea? You know, do you have any witnesses and who stole that idea? And it's like, where do you normally keep your ideas? Did you keep it under your bed? Did you keep it in your safe? Well, let's go and take an examine into that. It's like, well, no, it's not real. It's not tangible. It's not rivalrous. Ideas are infinite. When people are advocating for IP, they're advocating for a monopoly of patterns. That's all that these ideas are, monopoly patterns, in terms of preventing you from copying that, right? And using your own resources to do what you will with those patterns.
It's like making a t-shirt and saying, well, you can't make a similar design.
And the t-shirt is interesting because in the fashion industry, there is no IP and whatnot. Every fashion taste changes all the time. There's just not enough time to copyright everything because the taste of interest that people will have tomorrow will be different from today.
And innovation continues.
Right, yeah.
It's explosive.
And we still have t-shirts. Well, and
let's be facing the fashion world. Sometimes innovation is not so good because I've seen the latest fashions. They do a lot of retarded stuff.
But
yeah, I don't understand why we have to. People are so, well, if I have this idea, then it should be patent. Well, if you have this idea, then make it good, and then competition is going to keep you on your tiptoes to make it better.
Right. Get yourself a good marketing plan.
So I actually, I think that anybody who comes up with an intellectual idea or some sort of idea should patent it, but strictly for the fact that if you don't, you will be attacked by patent trolls. And that's it.
Well, in current society, I'm talking about if we in the regards of
no, the if you abolishment take all of this government, out. Yeah, no,
then
yeah.
No one should have it's not a tangible idea. It's not like this house. I can't come in here because this is not my establishment.
Right.
However, your mind, I mean, you can't physically own an idea. I mean, if you can't
physically own an idea. So theoretically, IP is complete crap. I mean, there's no philosophical backing behind intellectual property. And it's just strictly in the current paradigm is you have to patent something, patent an idea, strictly for a defense from patent trolls.
Because if you don't, someone else will patent your idea.
Right, exactly. They will patent it and then sue you and take the arms of the government against you. And, you know, I certainly do not support taking intellectual property as a, you know, oh, he did something that's similar to my idea, now sue him. That's terrible.
Yeah.
That's despicable. That's disgusting. And, you know, that sort of behavior is beyond the pale.
I guess something similar to what Tesla did would be also releasing the patents for everyone to kind of see how it's done and made to drive that kind of competition. I guess that's interesting. I have to kind of look into that more. Copywriting, you shouldn't really get yourself involved in that. A lot of this stuff is automatic by the government, and as soon as it's out there, in terms of like works of art, for example.
But you have to have record that it is what you produced, that you are the one who produced it. That's why people.
Bitcoin's write a great great thing about that, right? Bitcoin, you can also log in.
But the government doesn't recognize.
The world will recognize. Well, right. Yeah. The art world. No, forget the court. The art industry does. We'll recognize that. For example, they look very close at people for originality in terms of work of art. If it shows that you say that you're the original work of art, or this this just happened to this guy who went to this art fair and saw this painting that looked very similar to one of his photographs. And it turns out, this is a photograph that this guy made a painting of. This guy had been trying to sell this stuff for like at art shows and stuff like that, making a good deal of money. And then when it turned out, when he was confronted with this, he was like, oh no, it's my original idea. But then like, oh, his paintings are like paintings of his photographs. And all the art dealers like, whoa, you lied to us. You said this is original. And then they took him all down. He was shunned from the art community. Nobody would bring him into any of the art galleries because I can't take a risk as the owner of this gallery. I'm trying to, you know, you lied to me. I'm trying to show people authentic stuff. It turns out that you copied from this guy. You didn't even include that as being like, well, you know, I was inspired by this guy or whatnot, right? Shun, gone, right? There's sorts of ostracism there in effect, right? A lot of people like original stuff. A lot of people can tell the difference between knockoff brands and the good stuff, right?
Like Oakley, for example.
Yeah, Oakley. Or you go to a grocery store, you know, you have your food line and you have the regular product, right? And, you know, there's brand loyalty. There's a lot of stuff that goes into
Fruit Loops or Fruit Rings or whatever.
Yeah. You can have one or the other, but some people just like brand. There's a lot of different reasons why people buy a product. It's all subjective. It's not just because of one reason. And all that stuff takes into play and consideration.
And then as far as intellectual property goes with a photograph, if you take a photograph for business and that's your photograph, well then what about the people that made the building? Is it their property now because you took a picture of their building? Shouldn't they be a cut? Or the people that made the brick that made that building, or the people that put the, you know, so it's never ending. And what do you decide that it ends? You know, you can't. Right. So I get what you're saying.
Well, so one last thing, if you want to really see the ridiculousness of the logical conclusion of intellectual property, if you can hold that tablet up. This tablet has curved corners. Apple successfully sued somebody for using curved corners on their devices. And they were actually successful in their lawsuit. This is how ridiculous IP
is. And I'm pretty sure that Leonardo da Vinci did some curved stuff too, so maybe his family should sue Apple.
Absolutely.
Right? And then, you know, what about the people that created the first drawings? Cavemen should sue, you know, freaking Aristotle for doing it, or Leonardo da Vinci.
I think people could just stop patting all this stuff once they come to this realization, because, I mean, there's pretty much governments putting a gun in the middle of the room and trying to see who's going to go for it first. And that's why all these IP battles, Apple got involved, because they started getting sued. It's like, great, I guess we need to start patting it as well. You know, when the government opens a room, you got to go reach out the gun in case someone might grab it instead and shoot you with it. And that's where those square corners came from.
I don't think I'd say it. Apple and Samsung have an interesting little rivalry that they enjoy.
But it's a good rivalry, because then you have Apple making better stuff, and then you have...
Well, no, I mean, they have an IP rivalry.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah. Well, yeah, you know, that too.
We're
yeah.
using your technology, but yeah. come after us, you know?
Well, I guess I'm with you. I guess I used to have a Pirate Bay movie screening of... Star Trek, right?
Absolutely. As long as they keep up with this lawsuit, I will not support them with anything again.
I say we pirate it and then we make our own cheesy version. Right. Yeah, I'll paint myself green and I'll make up a species. I don't have to use their species.
Yeah, right. you can be the Orion slave girl. I'll get you the bikini. Yeah.
Okay. As long as I can dress up like Gandalf while saying use the Force.
Yeah, and you know,
I'll be Tim Allen's character.
Okay.
Unnecessary roles.
I hate you both.
Well,
may the Force be with you.
Well, thank you so much for watching. This has been an awesome show. For the patience for following through with that. Thanks for coming over, Aaron.
Yeah, definitely. Look forward to the future.
Absolutely, absolutely. And of course, a big thank you once more again to Stephen Rose for helping us and for believing us and investing. So with that, see you guys at the Victory Party and take good care. I'm Cal Molinay.
Aaron Thompson.
I'm Phil Pollard.
Victim to the material world.